Nigeria, also known as the Giant of Africa, is a country in West Africa that was once a British colony. The country is experiencing fast economic population growth. Why you bring that money to the club if you ain't doing it? And many people believe that the country has the potential to become Africa's powerhouse if it can get over the numerous obstacles standing in its way. It already has the largest economy on the continent, a substantial military budget, and significant participation in both the African and West African regions. Nigeria on the up and up. Nigeria is a nation on Africa's western coast. Its terrain is varied, with tropical temperatures that range from dry to humid. It has an abundance of agricultural land generally, but in the most densely populated regions of the southeast states, particularly in and around Kano, Katsina, and Sokoto, there is a severe scarcity of agriculture. Many Igbo, Ibibio, and Hausa people have been compelled to relocate to different regions of the nation as a result of this. Nonetheless, in many places that seem to have an abundance of arable land, access to farmland has been restricted by cultural customs, such as the ban on selling family land and in the far north. It's like possessing land has become second nature to Nigerian people. Also, its permanent forest reserves make up less than 10% of the country's total land area. Beyond these reserves, the majority of the country's forest has been destroyed due to frequent burning, which is done to clear land for farming or to promote hunting. Old habits die hard, right? The depletion of forests occur most frequently in areas with high population density like the Niger Delta and the drier savanna. In the dry zones of Sokoto, Kano, and Borno states, forest belts have been established to help stop the spread of the Sahara. Forest plantations have been developed in numerous waterways to preserve river basins and lower the frequency of soil erosion. If you liked the video so far, please consider liking and subscribing to the channel. One of the biggest economies in Africa is that of Nigeria. Its foundation has been the petroleum sector since the late 1960s. Transportation, construction, industry, and government services all saw significant economic growth as a result of a series of rises in the price of oil that began in 1973. Due to the large-scale rural to urban migration that resulted from this, agricultural output stalled to the point where cash crops like cotton, peanuts, and palm oil were no longer important export goods. It's like the rise of oil price cooked Nigeria's goose. Furthermore, it was compelled to import necessities like cassava and grains for domestic use starting about 1975. The system functioned effectively as long as petroleum earnings were steady, but due to its fast population expansion and the volatile global oil market, the agriculture sector has been experiencing a persistent problem since the late 1970s. Keeping the agricultural sector successful despite such downturns was like nailing jelly to the wall. The government started to privatize a number of state-run businesses in the late 1990s, mostly in the areas of transportation, power, and communications, with the goal of improving service quality and lowering reliance on the state. By the start of the 21st century, the majority of the businesses had been effectively privatized. However, some were still owned by the government. Close, but no cigar. Nigeria's government continued to struggle with irregular revenue flows at the start of the 21st century, and in an effort to improve things, it borrowed money from abroad and implemented a number of austerity measures. But sadly, it was like grasping at straws. Due to corruption infiltrating the operations of the government, an ever-increasing portion of the national budget was required for debt repayment, which meant that very little of Nigeria's GDP was going towards meeting the needs of the population there. It profited from a debt relief program enacted in 2005, which called for the forgiveness of the majority of its debt to the Paris Club, a collection of creditor nations, once a predetermined sum had been paid back. In 2006, Nigeria fulfilled this requirement and became the first nation in Africa to pay off its debt to the organization. Nigeria picked up the tap. Yay. VIP, I'm very important. Nigeria's economy is the biggest in Africa in terms of GDP. Between now and the early 2000s, we can see that it increased by sevenfold, all the way up to $477 billion. What is trade like in the country to prompt such a surge? Well, domestic commerce in staple foods is mostly conducted between major metropolitan centers in the southeast and southwest, as well as between distinct ecological zones in a north-south pattern. Plantains, cassava, kola nuts, and fruit are supplied by the southern states to the northern states, which then provide the southern states with cattle, beans, and onions. Central American yams are traded in the cities in the south and far north, The majority of manufactured products and food items are sold on the streets, in tiny neighborhood stores, and at open market booths. They must be raking in the money now. The principal destinations for Nigerian exports, which largely are made up of rubber, cocoa beans, and crude oil, are the EU member states, the US, and India. On the other hand, the primary imports include food, chemicals, machinery and transportation equipment, manufactured goods and food. The majority of these commodities are imported from the US, China and the EU. After gaining independence, it experienced a trade deficit due to the importation of large amounts of machinery and equipment. However, by the late 1960s, it experienced a trade surplus as the proceeds from the export of crude oil enabled for the importation of capital goods and industrial raw materials. The trade deficits got back in the mid-1970s, and ever since, the country's trade balance has fluctuated between times of surplus and deficit due to changes in the global oil market and choices made by the government regarding how best to allocate its finances. Nigeria must strike while the iron is hot. When one separates the economy of Nigeria into three sections, primary, which is agricultural and mineral extraction, secondary, which is manufacturing and services, one can evaluate how much each contributes to the GDP or employment of the nation. The industrial structure there has changed significantly since 1991. Let's dig this deeper. Nigeria is the new China. Why is that? Nigeria's economy now has a very different structure. Its economy is now mostly focused on industry and services rather than agriculture. Agriculture seems to be dead as a dodo. Industry and services have consistently accounted for around 74% of their GDP. Mechanization and migration from rural to urban areas have caused the number of people working in agriculture to fall. Its increasing political stability has led to a growth in manufacturing and services. Also, it has seen significant investments from nations including South Africa, the United States, and China. The service industry, particularly in the area of IT services, has grown significantly as well. Strike paid dirt. Even though it has the 11th largest oil reserves in the world and oil accounts for 90% of the country's foreign exchange earnings, refinery efficiencies, the high local demand for energy, and price fluctuations have created an economic dilemma. Therefore, its GDP is only minutely influenced by oil and gas, around 5-6%. Over 200 years of supply remain at the present rate of production and use. Its manufacturing industry is expanding at the quickest rate. Rapid economic expansion has resulted from a combination of the cheap and abundant labor supply and its large market, both domestically and internationally. Nigeria has finally found a place in the sun. By 2020, manufacturing was responsible for around 27% of Nigeria's GDP. Compared to the oil, gas, telecommunications, this one is expanding more quickly. Its inexpensive labor supply, expanding domestic market, and expanding infrastructure are likely to fuel the sector's growth and diversification. And from the new China to the new Silicon Valley. Lagos is Africa's Silicon Valley. 77 Nigerians relocate to Lagos per hour. In Lagos, anything takes place. It serves as their business and cultural hub and is the location of the nation's biggest independent film studio and oldest bank. It also serves as the center of the nation's fastest growing industry, technology. The biggest e-commerce business on the continent, Jumia, is based in Lagos. The vibrant megacity of Lagos is becoming known as a hub for tech innovation and entrepreneurship. Nothing succeeds like success. Some of Africa's most creative and prosperous firms, such as Andela, Paystack, Flutterwave, Kobo 360, Kuba Bank, and several more are based in Lagos. These businesses haven't only revolutionized sectors like finance and e-commerce, but they have also served as an inspiration to a new wave of investors and entrepreneurs around the continent. It is like Lagos pushes Nigeria's luck. However, it should come as no surprise that the most well-known firms in the city are in the financial space, as transferring money is still the biggest obstacle facing Africa. Lagos's tech firms are global in reach and have access to local investment via the expanding venture capital network. It seems like Lagos holds all the aces. They've installed nearly 2,900 kilometers of fiber optic infrastructure with the goal of connecting public schools, government buildings, hospitals, and other areas of attraction in order to increase internet access which is essential for startups. Over the last 20 years, we can see that the number of people that have access to the internet has reached over 50% of their population. In collaboration with the commercial sector, they have established 3,000 kilometers of optical duct infrastructure along the same routes. This will obviously bear fruit, because by doing this, Lagos's infrastructure development will be less tricky, which would improve connectivity. This will allow digital platforms to establish a local presence and make it easier for digital technology possibilities to spread. Within this ecosystem, the growth of these investments also offers 10 chances for talent development. Sadly, the story doesn't always end well. Nigeria has the most prosperous economy and population in Africa, but most of its citizens lack adequate chances. A Nigerian born in 2020 was predicted to be 36% as productive as what they might have become if they were given full coverage of health and education. It has the 7th lowest human capital index in the entire globe. The 3.5 million Nigerians who go into the labour force each year aren't well absorbed due to poor job creation and entrepreneurial possibilities. Plenty of employees instead migrate abroad in search of greater possibilities. Nigerians must be in a real pickle. With an estimated 84 million Nigerians living under the poverty line, the country is predicted to have the second highest percentage of poverty in the world, behind India, with a 37% poverty rate in 2023. There is still a great deal of spatial disparity there, where the best performing states score below the average for low-income nations, but the best performing areas compare well to upper-middle-income countries. State capacity is inadequate, service delivery is constrained, and violence and instability are pervasive across the majority of regions there. Was the economic success of Nigeria a Pyrrhic victory or what? Large gaps in the infrastructure make it difficult to acquire power and impede the integration of the domestic economy, which would enable the nation to take advantage of its sizable market. These persistent development concerns are exacerbated by new issues, including the rising intensity and frequency of extreme weather occurrences, particularly in the country's northern regions. Nothing is perfect. Restoring economic growth and pursuing structural changes will be possible with strengthened macroeconomic foundations. A better financed and more capable state that offers effective public services, public goods, and a favorable economic climate for the private sector to thrive and produce more high-quality employment for Nigerians is crucial. Fixing developmental issues is like kicking whales down the beach. Thanks for watching till the end. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to hit the like and subscribe buttons to receive more content. See you in the next video.